Thank you, Johannes. And what we're going to show you today is an outcome of a research project that we have carried out a few years ago, where we want to present how SMEs can successfully leverage patents and IP rights to the benefit of their business, but also to the benefit of the society. However, before we go and present you the main details, how SMEs use patent information and patent data in their daily business, but also to this, for the success of the company, let us first motivate and look at why actually SMEs should use patents and should use patent protection. As you can see on this slide, this is an outcome of a study that we have carried out together with the European, with the EU IP office, where we have tried to understand whether there's a difference in the performance of companies that are using IP rights, not only patents, but of course also trademark and designs, and those that do not use them. And indeed, the difference in the return per employee that we use as the indicator here was significant. So once you control for the country and the industries, you see that a company that is using IP rights has 55% higher turnover per employee than a company that does not use IP rights. But what is even more surprising is that the difference is much higher for SMEs than for large companies. So for SMEs, the difference is even 68%. However, we even went one step further and looked whether the performance premium is different if we look at those companies that use different types of IP rights. And for us, that was a kind of a signal or indicator that those companies understand how to use IP, because they know how to use patents, how to use trademarks and designs, and how to use the combination of those. And indeed, if we apply this filter, we see that companies that use a bundle of IP rights have almost twice as high turnover per employee, or the performance premium, that companies that do not use IP rights, which for us is an important indicator that companies need to not only to use IP rights, but also to understand how to use them and to understand how to manage IP. But the main ingredient to good IP management is good data on IP rights and good data on basically on the information that is provided and disclosed in patent documents.
In a second study, the Patent Commercialization Scoreboard, we have shed some light on the reasons why SMEs maintain their patents. And this was quite telling, as it shows that SMEs use a quite holistic approach when it is about their IP strategy. So the main reason why they maintain their patents is prevent imitation. So meaning to keep the copycats on distance. The second reason named was the reputation. The reputation towards the partners, their customers, their investors. Essential for SMEs is as well FTO, the freedom to operate, to be sure not to infringe third-party rights. Of course, patents also facilitate contracting, and in particular licensing, and it is of utmost importance for financing, for getting investors on board to secure sustainability of the business case. So, as said, it's a very holistic approach, and that was a very positive outcome from our point of view. And it was also interesting then to dig deeper into how this is going to be implemented, meaning how does the IP management look like? And here in particular, interesting is how SMEs approach the use of patent information. So SMEs use patent information, what is quite obvious, for analyzing the prior art. And we will dig into that deeper later on, but also to check the freedom to operate status, to explore the fields of use, in general to do patent analytics and to find out, for example, who are the competitors, who are potential partners, where to file for patents. So these are all important ingredients for an efficient and best of class IP management. Ilya?
However, what is also important to understand is that what we want to achieve is that companies, and especially SMEs, are able not only to use patents and to patent them, but also to reach the goals, which is market success, to bring a product on the market or a service, or to allow that maybe the partner that with whom they can cooperate brings the product or the service on the market. Therefore, within that study, we have also asked the question is, so how much or how many of the patented inventions for which protection has been sought at the EPO have actually been exploited? And here the result is very positive. So we found that over 2/3 of the inventions protected by European patents where we have a patent pending or pending application, we see that 2/3 of them are actually commercially exploited. Half of those by the company itself, by the SME, and the other half also together with the external partner, be it through licensing or be it to a joint venture or any other type of agreement. Indeed, that sounds positive. However, we also ask whether those companies see that there's still potential for even more exploitation. And indeed, for most of those companies, they said, yes, there is potential for more, but there are certain challenges or barriers that hinder them. And indeed, we know that to overcome those challenges, what is important is to have a good approach to decision making, and the basis for this is, of course, patent information.
First of all, it is essential to be absolutely sure where are the challenges. So the study, the patent commercialization scoreboard, addressed that issue. And here we have a ranking of the challenges identified by the SMEs. And the first two are finding the right partners and cost and complexity of negotiations. So that has to be addressed. Finding the right partners, also here, patent information can help. On the one hand, a patent that you file is a publication and can be found by others, meaning they can approach you to cooperate. On the other hand, you can do patent analytics and find out who are the companies in your field that are filing patents and that might be interested in cooperating with you, becoming a partner of you. So identifying partners via patent information is one of the means that should be on the checklist of SMEs. Less obvious is the influence on cost and complexity of negotiations. Here it is important to better understand where are companies losing time in the negotiations. And the feedback that we got from SMEs is that in the negotiations, there is a different understanding from the patent owner and the partner. Where does it stand in respect to freedom to operate? So is freedom to operate there? Then it's also about the patents. When patents are pending, it's often a long discussion what finally will be achieved, meaning what can be granted as valid claims. And then it's also important to understand what is the competitive landscape? Are the competitors close to that? Are there any substitutes? And these are things that hold up negotiations because that has an influence on the outcome of the overall cooperation with third parties. And to have more clarity on that, patent information is crucial. Ilya?
So what we took from the results of those studies is that we need to show, or at least to provide cases, how those challenges can be overcome, how patent information can be used to overcome those challenges, and also to show how actually real SMEs in Europe have done that, and to allow them to share their key insights and also the advice that they accumulated from mistakes, but also from success, and to share that with the audience. And that was the idea behind the project of creating the SME case studies, to demonstrate that European SMEs, when using patents, can create strategic value for them, but also that SMEs need to understand and to know when and how to use patents and patent information as the main input for decision makers in IP management and IP strategy. And what was also important is to pay actually attention to the diversity of the problems, in the sense that diversity in geography. So we cover 11 different European countries, because we know that every European country has a different setting, different policies, different demands from their customers. We created case studies covering seven different industries. Again, we know that biotech and pharma, they work completely different than the ICT sector. And the role that the patent plays in those industries differs as well. And the role that patent information plays on those differs as well. But what was even more important is that to show the differences is in the business models, meaning that we have SMEs that are more product-oriented, so they want to create the product and sell it themselves, while others have a licensing or platform-oriented model where they do the R&D, but then license the technology to another company, which then manufactures and sells the product. And at the same time, we also wanted to have companies that are rather startups and spin-offs, so starting almost from scratch, be it from a university or maybe from a larger company, but also mature companies that moved or switched their business model to more R&D savvy ones. So just to give you an example, Picote is a Finnish company that was actually very active in the construction business, but then at one point in time they realized that they have actually developed completely new tools to make their work easier, but at the same time they saw that those tools might also help others. So they developed into also an R&D company.
Just to add to that, the studies that we have shown at the beginning create statistical data. They show where the evidence is. But for an CEO or for an IP manager in a company, it is difficult then to understand what are the practical implications. So how to address the challenges in the daily operations. And the SME case studies let CEOs speak to other CEOs and tell them their stories and make it tangible. It makes it much more clear how that in practice is then broken down into action how is this is implemented. So we wanted to have it very practical, very praxis oriented, and everyone interested in the case studies should be able to find a case that is to some extent similar to their own situation and then learn from the colleagues. So that was the intention with the SME case studies, to bridge between the systematic big studies and then training and support for SMEs that want to advance their IP strategy and their IP management. Ilya?
So despite the heterogeneity that they showed in terms of geography, markets and business models, they are homogeneous in the sense that they are structured in the same way, but also that in all of them you will see that patent information is a key ingredient for many important decisions, which on this slide we have tried to categorize in five different categories. So you will find in those categories and see that patent information is important to the decisions for developing a market-ready product or service, to secure financing, of course, to obtain IP protection, to develop a business model, or maybe even to grow the business into another market or into another country. And indeed, there are many, many examples that you can find in those case studies.
So practical example for developing a market-ready product or service, that is that the SMEs, the companies, do a competitor analysis. They do prior art search and IP landscaping, and they learn from that. So as an example, when you analyze the competitor's patents, you can use that as an inspiration when you want to find alternative solutions for technical challenges. That was the way how Micrel medical devices succeeded and implemented the RFID technology that was created this way. The company Cosmed, the Italian company, they stressed, for example, how important it was for them to carry out in-depth prior art searches early in the creative process, even before they start with the research. They want to stand on the shoulders of the others, not to reinvent the wheel, but really to learn from the others and then to see where to advance the technology. Picotet and Infractus, they used IP landscaping and IP data mining to provide inputs to the company's R&D strategy from a top-down approach, so the development of new products. So many cases we have there which have shown how this is done in practice.
Yeah. Also, when it comes to securing, financing, as you can see, we just provided a few examples, but that was actually the case for most of them. Patent information helped to conduct an IP evaluation, so to understand, for the investor to understand what is actually the value of the IP and what is the value of the business that they wanted to invest in. Or to give you another example, Marinomed, they actually made a successful initial public offering, so an IPO, so to get external financing and basically to succeed in that and to convince people to buy their stocks, they had to undergo an IP due diligence, which is which was also disclosed to the potential investors. And indeed, at the end, it was a fully success and the company is thriving on their technology. But just to maybe to stress that point a bit more, why is patent information so crucial in when it comes to securing financing? It's because, and as many economic studies also shown, it removes the information asymmetry between the investors and the companies. Because the investors need actually to understand what is the knowledge, what is the technology, what is the market potential within Xplow, within Orca, within Skeleton, and therefore to make sure that they invest the right amount of money, but also that they charge the right price. So usually when a company has IP and can disclose it to the investors, that not only increases the probability to get financing, but also the probability to get a fair price for the money that they receive.
Connected to that topic, of course, is the IP protection as such. That's a common denominator for all the case studies that we did, because in nearly all the cases, when the SMEs did research, had their research outcomes, then it was about to identify what is really an invention. So it was about to see how can you make a difference to what is already known and what is actually new, to find what is novelty and what is inventive step. And that is also based on patent information. Without that, you cannot do that. And once it is clear how you structure your main claims, you want to address the applications. What are the application fields? Of course, the researchers have their view on that, and the reason why they started research was already a concrete application. But in order to be brought in for the future, you want to learn from others where they have seen maybe additional application fields. And then the next level is when you have already your patent filed and you want to expand the market coverage, where to file the patents. So where is it essential to cover important markets, but at the same time keep costs at a low level, so that you all can better understand when you look what others in the market that are successful, how they approach that. And so it's a peer-to-peer aspect, learning from the others by using patent information. Ilya?
Thomas, this is indeed very much related to the next category, which is develop a business model, because here companies use patent information to understand where is there maybe a potential new market, or maybe also to know basically with whom they can cooperate and to whom they can actually sell their product or license it to. And here, just to give you an example of two ICT companies, Fractus, a company which builds antenna, and Webdin, who's also active in the ICT sector. We know about this sector that there are many, many patents. For example, if you look at their mobile phone, you know that there are thousands of patents that are protecting all the technologies around it. So to navigate that and to find your market where you actually want to make money, you have to use patent information to navigate your way through it. And indeed, Fractus is a very interesting example because in the beginning, they have tried to manufacture the antenna themselves. But later on, they saw that there is an infringement problem when they started to do it themselves. And through patent information, they realized that they should rather turn the business around and implement a licensing strategy. And here, those decisions would not have been possible without the proper analysis of the patenting landscape in that market. And therefore, patent information was the prerequisite for the new business model and the market success at the end. Voltea is another example which used patent information to identify candidates to whom they could license their technology, which was actually applicable in many different industries, but to find out what are the industries they have used patent information to identify companies and other market players in those areas.
Ilya, that's a wonderful bridge to the next point, growing the business, because Voltea also used the patent information for their IP-supported transactions, and not only for licensing out, but also for getting technology on board. So what they did is they bought a company to acquire their patents to complement the existing patent portfolio they had at that time, and to facilitate freedom to operate. So they have seen a strategic need to fill gaps in their own patent portfolio and decided not to develop everything by themselves, but to acquire patents. So also SMEs acquire. So it's not only the business of big companies. If you know what your options are, an SME might be better off to acquire than invest only in own R&D and live open innovation. And the next part of growing the business, of course, is also the internationalization. So many of the examples that we have cover a certain market, so where they have a better access, where they have their headquarters, where they have good access to customers, to clients. But when it goes to different markets like Asia, so Orkan Energy is a very good example for that. Orkan Energy went from the European market to the Asian market with their solutions in the energy area by a strategic partnership with Asian companies, and have set up a joint venture there. A wonderful example to learn how you grow in a market where you don't have the resources to build up a sales machinery, where you don't have the experience how contracting is done, and many things that might be then quite complex for an SME located in Germany. But you can do it with the right partners, and then you can expand the business. And currently, Orkan Energy reports to us that they are growing so fast in Asia that this completely outperforms their traditional business in Europe. So an amazing example to learn how to internationalize.
Ilya? Thomas, maybe to add to that, I found the micro example also fascinating, because this is a kind of a where you really understand the risk of not using patent information, because the company was actually active in the UK on the market, but then they were faced with an infringement case. So they were apparently infringing on the patents of another company. And why? Because they missed, or for any reasons that existed back then, did not do a complete FTO analysis, and therefore risked infringing on another company's patents. And that was one of the main key messages or takeaways when we talk to them, is that now every time they enter a new market, they perform first an FTO to make sure that this doesn't happen again, because basically they lost all their shares, the market shares in the UK.
Indeed, so they learned their lesson, and now they are doing best practice because they have seen this is much more efficient if they proactively evaluate and not when it's in an advanced stage where you have already your investments done, and those investments become then risky because you have not done your homework with the patent information that is available.
So what we have tried to do with each and every case study, as I already explained, it reflects the key lessons learned by those companies, and they have shared them with us, and we are sharing them with the audience, so you can access them on the epo.org/SME website. And just to show you some key takeaways that you will find there, although some of them might sound easy, but I think it's very important not to forget them. Just a few examples: that you should use IP landscaping as input to R&D processes. That was Picotus' way to find new inventions, or to make new inventions, but also in the R&D strategy to see, for example, maybe in which area they should not be active because it's already very much developed.
It is, of course, also important to raise IP awareness across departments so that they work together for the same goal, and build up in-house expertise and create internal IP teams so that you have your own competence in the field, and everyone understands what is his role in the company and how he can contribute to the overall success.
But of course, every company should focus on their core business and also realize that if it becomes too complicated, that companies should also rely on external IP experts and get external IP advice. But what is important when doing that, at least the companies, most of them reported that it's important to establish long-term relationship with them and not short-term, even if it might be more expensive.
Indeed, and what is also best practice example is the to implement technology watch and competitor watch processes so that you have an alert system installed that automatically updates you what is going on, so that you have a continuous monitoring.
So all of those key takeaways and the case studies, and now we have recently added three additional ones about successful technology transfer journeys from European universities, you will find at epo.org/SME. So please feel free to use the material, and hopefully it will help you in developing your business. Thank you very much, Johannes.
Thank you.